In this video, we're going to talk about the events that occur before cell division. Before a cell is actually able to divide, it needs to do a few things. Now, the cell is the basic unit of life. It's the smallest unit that has all the characteristics of life. And these cells, because they are living, they are finite. They have a limited lifespan. Any one individual cell is only going to live for so long, and then that cell will either die, or another possibility is that that cell will divide. So prior to that cell expiring or dying, it may instead divide to form two daughter cells. In this way, life continues from one cellular generation to another. Now, what's the significance of cell division? Well, it all depends on the type of organism that we're dealing with. For a unicellular organism, by dividing into two cells, it has reproduced. We went from one organism to two organisms. This is how offspring are formed. Two daughter cells have resulted from a single parent cell. In bacteria, this form of reproduction is known as binary fission. And it is the simplest form of cell division. In contrast, for a multicellular eukaryotic organism, each time a cell divides doesn't mean that that organism has reproduced, but this cell reproduction is essential for renewal, repair, and growth of tissues and organisms. As the previous video had stated, you are larger now than you were when you were born, in main part because of this cell division. Because your number of cells has increased through cell division. Now that doesn't mean you are constantly reproducing, although multicellular organisms do require specific types of cell division for reproduction to occur. The division of a eukaryotic cell is more complicated. Compared to that of a prokaryotic cell. And in fact, in this chapter, we will discuss two different forms of eukaryotic cell division. So if a cell is going to divide, we need to know a bit about its genetic material and what it needs to do with that genetic material. DNA is the most important source of information. That a cell needs to function. DNA determines which proteins are made in a cell, how much of those proteins are made, and when those proteins are made. And so a cell must have its DNA in order to be alive and to function. Before a parent cell divides, it copies its chromosomes. So what are chromosomes? Well, a chromosome is a complex of DNA and protein. The DNA holds the information, and the protein is there just as a support structure or a scaffold for that DNA. Now, prokaryotic cells have a single chromosome, while certain eukaryotic cells can have over 100 chromosomes in each cell. So, if a cell is going to divide, it must copy its DNA, it must copy its chromosomes. The duplicated chromosomes are then divided between the two new cells formed by cell division. The resulting daughter cells are going to be genetically identical. I'd like to show you the structure of a duplicated chromosome. So a duplicated chromosome sort of this large X-shape molecule. Now, this is two copies of the DNA, or two copies of the information of a chromosome. And in fact, the two halves of these duplicated chromosomes, they are known as sister chromatids. So the entire X-shaped structure is a duplicated chromosome, whereas each of these sections is a sister chromatid. Now, these two sister chromatids are connected at the middle of this molecule. And that central structure we call the centromere. So this region of connection between the two chromosomes is the centromere. Also, on either side of the centromere, there are these plaques of proteins known as kinetochores. We'll see the function of kinetochores in greater detail in just a moment, but they are the attachment sites for microtubules during cell division. So again, to recap, the entire X-shaped molecule is the duplicated chromosome. It's made up of two sister chromatids connected to each other. So each half of the X is a sister chromatid. Those two sister chromatids are connected at the centromere, the central portion, and there's a kinetochore found on either side of the centromere. Now, you may be looking at this molecule and saying, that doesn't look like any model of DNA I've ever seen. The DNA I've always seen looks like sort of a twisted rope ladder and a long, thin molecule, not some weird X. Well, let's talk about that. DNA molecules are enormously long. In fact, the DNA of a single human cell is nearly 2 meters in length. For some individuals, the length of DNA in a single cell is taller than they are. Now, you might think, with that much DNA in a single cell, that if you took all the DNA out of a person's body and lined it up end to end, you might be able to make it around the Earth or something like that. Well, it turns out it's even more than that. You might think, okay, well, maybe I can stretch here from the Earth to the Moon. It's even farther than that. In fact, the length of DNA that an individual has in their body is approximately 133 astronomical units in length. An astronomical unit is the distance between the Earth and the Sun. So the DNA of a single human is longer than the diameter of our entire solar system. This is an incredible length of molecules within our human cells. And so if there wasn't some way to keep that DNA organized, if there wasn't some way to package all that DNA together, there'd be no way our cells could manage it and copy that DNA. So DNA is tightly packaged. With proteins. And we call that structure a chromosome. Each chromostrome is one double-stranded molecule of DNA wrapped around a protein scaffold. Now, if it's a duplicated chromosome, then we have two molecules of DNA because that DNA has been copied. So that X-shaped molecule which I had drawn in that previous slide. This is the molecule I'm talking about down at the bottom. It's made up of a bunch of these thick supercoils all wrapped up around each other. And when we look at that thick supercoil, it's made up of a bunch of tight helical fibers wrapped around each other. And then when we look at that helical fiber, it's made up of a bunch of nucleosomes wrapped around each other. When we look at what a nucleosome is double-stranded DNA wrapped around a histone core. So we see DNA in its least condensed form up at the top, and DNA in its most condensed form down at the bottom of this diagram. Now, the last thing I'd like to talk about before we discuss the events of cell division are going to be the number of chromosomes that human cells have. Individual chromosomes are only visible in the cell during cell division, during mitosis. Normally, the chromosomes are in a diffuse mass within the nucleus known as the chromatin. But if we're able to pause a cell while it's preparing to divide, the number and shape of the chromosomes can be studied. A picture, a photograph of the chromosomes is known as a karyotype, and here we see the karyotype of a human female. Now, one thing I want to emphasize, in this particular karyotype, you see that some chromosomes are colored in blue, some chromosomes are colored in pink. Those are the chromosomes from this individual's father and from this individual's mother. Another thing to emphasize is that each of these pairs of chromosomes aren't one X-shaped molecule, but instead we're looking at two X-shaped chromosomes. So this pair of chromosomes, one duplicated chromosome from the individual's mother, one duplicated chromosome from the individual's father. So humans have a total of 46 chromosomes, 23 from our mother, 23 from our father. In fact, those 46 chromosomes, as I had mentioned, are arranged into 23 pairs of chromosomes, with one chromosome of each pair coming from each parent. 22 out of those 23 chromosomes are known as autosomes. But you can think of these as the non-sex chromosomes. They aren't involved in determining biological sex. However, one of those pairs of chromosomes are the sex chromosomes. Of the 22 autosomes, they are always homologous, meaning they're chromosomes of the same size, they have the same number of genes, the same order of genes. Whereas the sex chromosomes may be homologous, that's the case for females, where they have two copies of the X chromosome. Or the sex chromosomes may be different, that's the case for males, where they have one X and one Y. The last topic we'll discuss before we discuss cell division are the centrosomes. Now, I had mentioned the centrosomes when talking about the cytoskeleton. Each eukaryotic cell has a pair of structures which help organize the microtubules of the body. These centrosomes are important for dividing duplicated chromosomes during cell division. So these are also structures that are copied during interphase, during these events that occur before cell division. In our next video, we'll talk about the steps of mitosis, the events of cell division.